So let's start the next concept, which is about relative motion. Okay. Now, a couple of things to understand about relative motion. So firstly, whenever we write any kinematical equations or any equations to describe the motion of a body, it is always in relation to, or it is always relative to, given coordinate frame or a given reference frame, what we call. And typically, there is no such thing as an absolute reference frame. Because even when we consider a reference frame that is attached to the ground, so-called, or the surface of the earth, considering that the earth itself is in a complex motion as far as space is concerned, and again, I mean, to consider motion, relative motion in space itself, one would have to consider that galaxies are in motion with respect to the absolute universe, etc. So it becomes a very complex process in trying to define an absolute reference frame. So rather than define an absolute reference frame, what we say is that we can only define the equations of motion relative to a given reference frame. Okay. Now, what we are looking at in relative motion is if we consider two different reference frames. Okay. Not necessarily that we are defining any one of them as an absolute frame, but we are just defining two reference frames which are in motion with respect to each other. Then how can we convert the equations of motion in one relative to another? So let's try to put this in simple terms. Let's say we have one observer who is moving with respect to another, like a person inside a car, another person stationary on the ground or standing on the road, and there's a third person moving on a bicycle or something. So how the person standing on the road would write the equations of motion, how the person traveling on the car would write equations of motion for the biker, and how these equations would be related to each other. That is basically the subject matter of relative motion. So first up, we will look at relative motion in one dimension. Okay. So as far as relative motion in one dimension is concerned, we'll start with the very basic parameters, which are position, velocity, acceleration, etc. And from that, we'll learn to write equations of motion. So basically, if we say that the axis of motion is my x-axis, this point is the origin, and let us say I have one point over here whose position is xa, and I have another point over here whose position is xb. Then the relative position of b with respect to a would be this vector. So this would be x of b with respect to b. So we would define relative position of b with respect to a as the parameter xb. And as we can see from the example, it is xb minus x. That means with respect to a common origin or common reference frame in this case, which is the x-axis, if we have recorded the positions of A and B to be xB and xA respectively, then the position of B with respect to A becomes xB minus xA. Okay. Now once we are clear with the understanding of relative position, we can see relative displacement S of B with respect to A is just defined as the change in position of B with respect to A. So that becomes the change in XB minus XA, because that is how we have defined the relative position. So that just reduces to delta XB minus delta X. So in other words, the displacement of B with respect to A reduces to nothing but the displacement of B minus the displacement of A. So just as we have defined relative position as position of B minus position of A, we can now define the relative displacement as the displacement of B minus the displacement of A. Now, for example, if we consider the bodies to be in motion, then we can look at relative velocity as the rate of change of the relative displacement, which is the rate of change of displacement of B minus displacement of A. So that becomes the velocity of B itself minus the velocity of A. So this helps us understand, for example, if we have a car traveling at a speed of 20 kilometers per hour and a truck traveling at a speed of 30 kilometers per hour in the same direction, then the velocity of the truck as seen by the car or relative to the car will become 10 kilometers per hour. So to the driver of the car, it will seem like the truck is going ahead at 10 kilometers per hour. But on the other hand, for example, if there is a car traveling at 10 kilometers per hour, and there's a bike traveling towards him at, let us say, 30 kilometers per hour. So in this case, the velocity of the bike with respect to the car will become the velocity of the bike, which is minus 30, minus the velocity of the car, which is plus 10. So it will become minus 40. So basically what will happen here is that to the car driver, it will seem like the bike is traveling at a speed towards him, at a velocity towards him, therefore negative of 40 kilometers per hour. So that in essence is the application of relative velocity in the two possible situations in the case of one dimensional relative motion, that is either both the objects are moving in the same direction, in which case it becomes a difference of their speeds, or they are traveling in opposite directions, in which case it becomes the sum of their speeds. Now similarly, we can define relative acceleration. As the rate of change of relative velocity so that as you can see will become the difference of the individual accelerations. This is another definition. So let us look at some examples of application. Okay, so this is the situation that is given to us, that looking at the aerial view of a car which is beginning the process of overtaking a bus, and the car is traveling at a constant speed of 72 kilometers per hour, whereas the bus is traveling at a constant speed of 36 kilometers per hour. So we have to find the time taken by the car to overtake the bus. How much time does the car take to overtake the bus? So as you can see, this type of problem can be solved quite easily if we bring in the concept of relative motion. Okay. So as per the concept of relative motion, it will be more convenient for us to understand the problem from the point of view of an observer on the bus. So to the observer on the bus, at t equal to 0, let's say, the car starts overtaking. So the velocity of the car with respect to the bus is how much? Is the velocity of the car minus the velocity of the bus? So here they are both traveling in the same direction. That is 36 kilometers per hour. So that is 10 meters per second. So the relative velocity of the bus, or rather of the car with respect to the bus, is 10 meters per second. So to the person sitting on the bus, it will look like the car is going past at a speed of 36 kilometers per hour, 10 meters per second. Now let's say the overtake is complete in some t seconds. So when the overtake is complete, the car would be here as far as this observer is concerned. So this is at t equal to t when overtake is completed. And t equal to 0 was when overtake started. So the displacement of the car from the initial till the overtake is over, relative to the bus, of course, you can see is the length of the bus, which we have taken as 15 meters, plus the length of the car, which was given to us as 5 meters. So it is 15 plus 5 or 20 meters. So since the relative displacement of the car with respect to the bus is 20 meters, we can say that it takes a time of 2 seconds for the overtake to complete. Okay, so just take that down. That's one type of question. Alright, so let's understand this particular question here. Say that elevator is accelerating upwards at a constant rate, and at a particular instant of time, a man standing inside the elevator drops a coin. So given that he drops the coin from a height of 2 meters above the floor, we have to find the time taken. So let's understand the solution. Another thing is, let's say at that time t1, in the elevator at a speed of 10 meters per second and an acceleration of 1 meters per second square, the man drops the coin. And let's say at sometime t2, so as you can see, it's very difficult to trace the displacement of the coin in the ground frame. Let's say T2 is T1 plus delta T. However, if you look at the motion of the coin relative to the elevator, it's a very simple situation. At t equal to t1, the coin is here, at t equal to t2, the coin reaches here. Okay. Now the thing is, the axis, so if we take the vertical direction as our positive axis, you can see that at this point of time, the velocity of the coin is equal to the velocity of the elevator, is equal to plus 10. But between here and here, the acceleration of the coin is minus g. It's coming down at, whereas the acceleration of the elevator, including the floor of the elevator, is plus a or plus 1 meters per second. So using this information, we can see that at t equal to t1, the initial velocity of the coin with respect to the elevator is 0. Because they have the same velocity at that moment, so their relative velocity is 0. Okay. Or basically, to the person inside the elevator, when he drops the coin, at that instant he is dropping it at rest with respect to himself. So the initial velocity of the coin is 0. However, the coin itself is accelerating downwards at G, whereas the elevator floor is accelerating upwards at A. So the acceleration of the coin with respect to the elevator will become minus of G, minus of plus. So it will become minus of 9.8 minus 1, or minus 10.8 meters per second. So this is the acceleration of the coin with respect to the elevator, whereas this is the initial velocity of the coin with respect to the elevator. So we can see that the displacement of the coin with respect to the elevator will be half acceleration of the coin with respect to elevator to t square. Okay. So this displacement is 2 meters downwards. So minus 2 is the displacement, should be equal to half into minus 10.8 into t2 minus t1. So that will give us the solution we are looking for, right? So solving this, we can get t2 minus t1. Just make a note of that. This will give us the time interval t2 minus t1 as approximately 0.61 seconds. Look at this particular problem next. Right, so it says here that one particular train is moving at a velocity v1 and starts decelerating at the rate of a, so that it does not collide with another train which is moving at v2 and its acceleration is 0. And the distance between them is equal to t right now. Let us see, this is frame 1 and this is frame 2, and it is given to us that v2 is less than v1. So we have to find the minimum value of d so that collision does not occur. Now once again, this problem becomes easy to solve if we look at the motion from the relative motion point of view, or we look at the motion of one of the trains with respect to the other, right? So for example, let us say we look at the motion of train 1 with respect to train 2. So if we do that, then at t equal to 0, train 1 is over here. It has a relative velocity with respect to train 2 or something, and it has a relative acceleration or something, and its initial position is at a distance of. So at some time t, let's say, the train 1 will have a displacement of so much with respect. So from the data above, we can see that initial velocity of train 1 with respect to 2 is v1 minus v2. And we can see acceleration of train 1 with respect to 2 is minus a minus 0, so that is minus a. So from that we can see that the displacement, so this is uniform deceleration. So the relative motion of train 1 with respect to 2 is one where the deceleration is uniform. Okay. So we can see that displacement of train 1 with respect to 2 is initial velocity into time plus half relative acceleration into t square. So we can say that is v1 minus v2 t minus half And we can also say that the velocity of train 1 with respect to 2 is so much. So now we can see that at the instant when it comes closest, if the relative velocity is 0, then this displacement is the maximum. In other words, what this observer will see is that the train is displacing, then coming to a halt, and then going back. So at the moment when it comes to a halt, the train 1 has made the maximum displacement with respect to train 3. Of course, it's coming to a halt with respect to train 2, not in the ground frame. So keeping that in mind, next up we can see from these equations that when S12 is maximum, the relative velocity should be 0. Okay. So from equation 2, relative velocity is 0 at t equal to V1 minus V2 at A by A, okay? And from equation 1, the maximum value of this displacement is therefore into this time also. So solving this, we will see that this maximum displacement comes out to be this much, and this should be less than equal to 2. That gives us this. So that is another example, interesting problem related to relative motion. Alright, so let's look at this problem next. So, taking a sort of bird's eye view, the top view of the situation, let us say this is the road connecting town A and town B. Now, there's a stream of buses going in this direction with the speed V, all of them, and there is a stream of buses in the opposite direction also going with the speed, and if the time interval between two buses is capital T, then you can see that the distance between any two consecutive buses be equal to V, same property. Now in the midst of all this, there is our cyclist, bicyclist, who is travelling at a speed of say V cycle of 20 kilometers per hour. And what he sees is that there is a bus overtaking him or going past him every 18 minutes, and there's a bus crossing him or going past him from the opposite direction, the opposite line, every 6 minutes. So from this we have to find out V. So let us look at the motion of the buses relative to the cyclist. So, this stream of buses that is traveling in the same directions, that will have a relative velocity of, now remember the cyclist is going in the same direction, So in his frame, the relative velocity will become the velocity of the bus minus the velocity of the cyclist. That will become V minus 20 in kilometers per hour. And the distance between consecutive ones is T. And for the stream of buses that are going in the opposite direction, let's say the velocity is V relative prime. Okay. Now this is in the opposite direction. So the relative velocity would be his velocity plus this velocity. So it would be V plus 20 kilometers per hour. And the gap between any two consecutive buses is. So if a bus crosses him every 18 minutes from the same side, you can see that 18 minutes is the time taken for these buses to travel a distance of t relative to him. Okay, so this should be equal to d divided by v relative, or the relative speed of the buses which are overtaking him. Okay, so in other words, they should be equal to vt divided by v minus 20. Okay, so that's the first equation. And similarly, the buses which are crossing him from the other side, they cross him every 6 minutes. So 6 minutes is the interval of time that it takes for a bus to travel a distance d in the direction opposite. Okay, so that should be the distance d divided by the relative velocity of the buses traveling in the opposite direction. So that should be equal to vt divided by v plus 20. So that's our second equation. Now, as you can see, we have to just solve these two equations for the value of v, okay, which you can do quite easily now. So solving equation 1 and 2, you can see that vt from both of them is equal to 18 minutes into v minus 20, which is equal to 6 minutes into v plus 20. So in other words, v plus 20 is equal to 3 times v minus 20. In other words, 2v is equal to 80, or v is equal to 40 kilometers per hour. So once you've got that the velocity is equal to 40 kilometers per hour, you can also see that this relative velocity is 20 and that relative velocity is 60. So to him it will seem like buses are going past him or overtaking him at a speed of 20 kilometers per hour, whereas the stream of buses that are going the opposite direction are crossing him at a speed of 60 kilometers per hour. So this is an important type of significant problem. First up, let's look at the motion of the ball relative to the man while the lift is ascending. Okay. Now, let's take this as a positive axis. So the initial velocity of the ball relative to the elevator is plus v. Okay. That is given to us. Acceleration of the ball in the ground frame is minus g. Acceleration of the elevator is plus e. So acceleration of the ball with respect to the elevator is minus of g plus e. Then this minus this. This. So therefore, displacement of the ball with respect to the elevator is ut plus half. So that will become minus half g plus e. Now from this equation we can see that t equal to 0, the ball goes up and then comes down and reaches down at t1. Okay, so the displacement of the ball with respect to the elevator is 0 at t equal to t1. So from this equation we can see that t1 is equal to 2v divided by g plus e. That's our first equation. Okay, next let's look at the situation when the elevator is descending. So when the elevator is descending with an acceleration E, its acceleration is E, and while the ball is airborne, its acceleration is G. Okay. So this time what is happening is with respect to the person who has thrown the ball up with the speed V, the initial velocity of the ball with respect to the elevator will be plus V again, taking the upward direction as positive. This time the acceleration of the ball in the ground frame is minus G. However, the acceleration of the elevator in the ground frame is also minus A, because the elevator is going down with an acceleration of A. So the relative acceleration of the ball with respect to the elevator becomes this minus this. So it becomes minus of G minus, or minus G plus A. So therefore, the displacement of the ball with respect to the elevator this time is Vt minus half G minus A. And we can see that at t equal to t2, the displacement should be 0. So from here you can see that t2 is 2V divided by G minus. And now these equations can be solved for various things, including V or whatever. Okay, so doing that next. So solving equation 1 and 2, you can see for example that G plus A into T1 is equal to G minus A into T2. So A into T1 plus T2 is equal to G into T2 minus T1, or A is equal to T2 minus T1 upon T1 plus T2. That is one option. And we can also see that adding these two equations, you can see that this option is correct. And of course, the acceleration of the ball in the ground frame is equal to minus G. So that option. Okay, next example. Puzzle type of problem here, where what is happening is that two buses are continuously headed towards each other, and while they are on this kind of collision path headed towards each other, there is a bird which is backing and forthing between them, and we have to make all sorts of calculations between them. So let's look at the problem visually first. Let's say this is the situation at time t equal to 0. See that this is when the bird starts from the first truck. So the velocity of the bird with respect to the second truck will become 90 kilometers per hour, because they're traveling towards each other, and the distance between them is 60 kilometers. So the time when the bird reaches the second truck, T1, let's say, will be 60 divided by 90, or 2/3 of an hour. But that is basically 40 minutes. So that picture will now look like this. By 3 hours, you can see that this truck is displaced through 20 kilometers. So as this displaced through 20 kilometers, so now the distance between these two has changed from the initial distance to the relative velocity, which is 60 into 2/3, so that is 40. So it has reduced to 20 kilometers. So at this point of time, the bird turns back, it starts moving towards this way. And let's say at time T2, has reached this truck. So as you can see, now T2 minus T1 will be the time in which the bird has made a relative displacement of 20 with respect to truck 1. So displacement of the bird with respect to truck 1 divided by velocity of the bird with respect to truck 1. So that is 20 divided by relative velocity is again 60. 90. So this is this time 2/9. So that being the case, this displacement is 20/3 kilometers. 20/3 kilometers. So you can see that every time the bird goes from one to the other, the distance between the trucks has reduced by a factor of 1/3. Like the first time it goes from 1 to 2, the distance has changed from 60 to 20. And second time it goes from 2 back to 1, the distance is changed to 20/3, like this. So we can say that each journey of the bird is like this. First one, time T1 is 2/3 hours, and the distance between the trucks has reduced to 60/3 or 20. Then second journey, at the end of the second journey, the time is T1 is, the time taken for the journey T2 minus T1 is 2/9 hours, and the distance between the trucks at the end of it is 20/3 or 60/9. Like that, at the end of the nth journey, so this is what we can conclude from this information. So just absorb this and then we'll come to the solution of the particular questions. Conclude is, after n journeys, the distance between the trucks and the total time is the time. Okay. So basically you can see that if total number of journeys is capital N, then the distance between the trucks at the end of the N journey should be zero. So 60 upon 3 to the power N should be equal to zero. That means n is infinite. So typically what this suggests is that it takes infinite number of trips before the trucks collide. Of course, practically speaking, this will not be true because it will not be possible for the bird to make journeys between the two trucks before the distance becomes zero. Actually, when the distance reaches a critical minimum between the two, and let's say that minimum can be something very small, like even maybe 5 millimeters, at that point of time the bird cannot go back and forth anymore because the bird has a certain turning radius. So keeping that in mind, this should actually be tending to zero, not exactly zero. So if this is a fixed number, for example this is 5 millimeters or 5 centimeters or half a meter or something like that, you'll get a fixed value of the number n. But again, given that the initial distance was 60 kilometers, there'll be a pretty large number n. Instead of taking this as zero, if you take it as a very small number, like 5 millimeters or something, you will get a very large value of n. So that shows that a large number of trips can be made, but nonetheless, keeping that limiting situation in mind, the number of trips is finite and not infinite. So that is one part. And about the total distance traveled, it's a much easier thing actually. The total time you can see is when the trucks collide, the total time till the trucks collide. Is the relative displacement of truck 1 with respect to truck 2 divided by the relative velocity of truck 1 with respect to truck 2. So you can see that the relative displacement between the trucks by then will be 60 kilometers and the relative velocity is 60 kilometers per hour, sum of their velocities. So keeping that in mind, the total time taken is 1 hour. Now during that time the bird is traveling at a constant speed of 60 kilometers per hour. So the total distance traveled by the bird is equal to speed of the bird multiplied by time. So that, as you can see, will be 60 kilometers. So the bird would have traveled for a total distance of 60 kilometers as it's going back and forth, but interestingly enough, it would have made a very large number of trips back and forth. So that is the conclusion to this particular problem. So let us look at this problem next. Now, this being the situation, now taking the upward axis as positive, you see the initial velocity of A is 0 and the initial velocity of B is plus u or plus 40 meters per second. So the relative velocity of, if you see B with respect to A, that is plus 40. Right. Now what we are going to do is, since we are talking about the time when they collide with each other, just think of the motion of stone B with respect to the stone A. So to stone A, it will look like the stone B is coming up straight to it. So it will look like in the time when the collision has happened, the stone B has made a displacement of 60 meters, right? So now acceleration of stone A is also minus g, and acceleration of stone B is also minus g. The important thing is acceleration of stone B with respect to A is 0. If you look at this equation and this equation together, they show us that the motion of B with respect to A is at uniform velocity UBA equal to 40 meters per second. Therefore, the displacement of stone B with respect to A should be 40 t as a function of time. Now, when they collide, the displacement of stone B with respect to A should be plus 60 meters, because initially stone B was 60 meters below, and when they collide, stone B is right at stone A. So in A's frame, it looks like B has travelled up by 60 meters, right? So using these two equations, we can see that three by two over 1.5 seconds. That is done. Okay. At the moment when they are crossing each other, from this we can also see that the velocity of B with respect to A minus, because it's a downward motion, so it is that verifies what we have already understood earlier, that the relative motion is constant and relative velocity is constant at 40 meters per second. Get another question next. Let's take a look at this question. we change the data of the question a little bit. So let's make the acceleration 1 meter per second square. Let's make the initial distance 5 meters. Okay. Alright. So let us look at the solution with the corrected values. So let us put an observer on B. Okay. So we look at the motion of A. Relative to B. So when we are looking at the motion of A relative to B at t equal to 0, okay, initial velocity of A is 15, acceleration of A is 0, initial velocity of B is 10, acceleration of B is 1. So from this we can see that initial velocity of A with respect to B is 5 and acceleration of A with respect to B is minus 1. So basically, to begin with, it looks like he's moving at an initial velocity of 5, but a relative acceleration of minus 1 meter per second square, and initially this distance is 5 meters. Okay. So let's say at some time t1, A overtakes so what has happened from here to here is that the displacement of A with respect to B should have become 5 meters plus 5. So from this information, you will see that displacement of A with respect to B is 5t minus 1 by 2t square. So at t equal to t1 is 0, is 5. So 5t minus 1 by 2t square is equal to 5. 1 by 2 t square minus 5 t plus 5 is equal to 0, or t is equal to 5 seconds. Now let us say that at t equal to t2, B overtakes A. So at that moment it will look like B has now got more speed than A. Okay. But again you can see that at this time t2, the displacement of A with respect to B from the initial moment is again 5 only. Okay. So basically what is happening, that the displacement of A with respect to B is 5 at not only t1 but also t equal to t2. So both at time t1 and t2, when A and B are basically crossing each other, the relative displacement is 5 meters. So one of the times is 5 minus root 15, the other time is 5 plus root 15, and basically the shorter time is when A overtakes B and the longer time is when B overtakes A. Conclusion, what we can see is that the time t1 when A overtakes B will be 5 minus root 15, or approximately 5 minus 3.9 seconds, and the time when B overtakes A again will be 5 plus 2.15, or approximately 5 plus 3.9 or 8.9 seconds. So that is the conclusion of this particular problem. So we have this situation: a hot air balloon okay so let us say this is the next particular question we are looking at. Let's understand the situation geometrically. So the particular stone we are talking about, the particular hot air balloon we are talking about, is at some particular instant of time at a height of 200 meters, sorry, 50 meters from the earth and is going up at a uniform speed of 10 meters per second, acceleration equal to zero, when the ball is dropped. So since our experiment is starting at this point of time, let's take this as t equal to zero. So basically what will happen here is that the initial velocity of the ball with respect to the balloon is zero, okay, because it's dropped in the balloon's frame. So therefore, since velocity of the balloon is equal to 10 meters per second upwards, initial velocity of the ball will also be 10 meters per second upwards. Okay. So this and this become significant. Now also, the acceleration of the ball will be minus g, so that is minus 10 meters per second squared downwards. And the acceleration of the balloon is given to us as zero because of the buoyant force acting because of the helium inside. Okay, so from this we can see that the acceleration of the ball with respect to the balloon is equal to minus 10 meters per second. So now this equation and this equation become significant, and we are looking at the motion of the ball with respect to the balloon, whereas this equation and this equation become important when we are looking at the motion of the balloon, the ball in the ground frame. Alright, so let us say at t equal to 0, this is the situation. Now, t equal to 2 seconds, let's understand what happens. So, by then, what has happened? The balloon has gone up by a certain distance, and the ball has probably reached down by a certain distance. So, in this picture, we can see that this particular thing will be the displacement of the ball with respect to the ground, whereas this particular distance will be the displacement of the ball with respect to the ground. So those are the two different things we are looking at. So what we can do here is that we can first look at motion of the ball in the ground frame. So doing that, the initial velocity will be taken as plus 10, okay, and the acceleration will be taken as minus 10. So the displacement will be this is the quantity. So this quantity will become 10 meters in that. Right. Just make a note of that first. Oh, wait. Let's make this 3 seconds. This becomes 30 minus. In the same situation, if we now look at the motion of the ball relative to the balloon, will see initial velocity is 0. The relative initial velocity was 0, we had seen that. And the acceleration is minus 10. So the displacement of the ball with respect to the balloon will be minus 5 t square. So at t equal to 3 seconds, the displacement of the ball with respect to the balloon, that will be minus. So this whole thing will be 45 while this is 50. So that is okay. Now the time taken by the ball to hit the ground, let's calculate that next. So let's say that at some time t, so this is the displacement of the ball as seen in ground. Balloon will be somewhere above here. Right. So with respect to the ground frame, the displacement of the ball should be equal to minus 50 meters. Okay. The initial velocity was plus 10 and the acceleration is minus 10 meters per second square. So using the equation, S is equal to ut plus half a t square. Okay. You can see that this equation will give us t square minus 2t minus 10 is equal to 0. So obviously we won't take the negative root, so that time and that will be approximately 4.32 seconds. That concludes this problem. Right, so with that we conclude relative motion in one dimension. Next up we'll be looking at projectile motion a little bit.